Excellent. Hi, everyone. I'm Will Smith. I'm a bookseller at Sam Reed's in Grasmere, the independent bookshop, which has been in the village for over a century. We are delighted this evening to be in the presence of Sarah Thomas to talk about her debut environmental memoir, The Raven's Nest. That is the cover, beautiful as it is, from Atlantic Books. So as I said earlier, we will be recording this evening, and we also have subtitles available for you to help discern some of what I say and hopefully most of what Sarah says, and hopefully they'll capture any Icelandic that comes up in our conversation too. So we are optimistic for all of that. I have a small bio for Sarah, which I shall now read from to introduce her to those who don't know and have just come across the book. Although I am appreciating there's a large fan base here this evening who will already have prior association in various ways with Sarah. Sarah is a writer and documentary filmmaker with a PhD in interdisciplinary studies. Her films have been screened internationally. She's a regular contributor to the journal Dark Mountain, and her writing has also appeared in The Guardian and the anthology Women on Nature, edited by Catherine Norbury, another friend of Sam Reed's. In 2020, Sarah was nominated for the Arts Foundation Environmental Award. She was also longlisted for the inaugural Nan Shepherd Prize and shortlisted for the 2021 Fitzcarraldo Essay Prize for the proposal for this book. And this is her debut. So welcome, Sarah. Thank you so much for being with us this evening. I'm delighted to get the chance to chat to you about this, which I should also mention is Cumbria Life Book of the Month for August. And there's no higher prize than that. thank you for joining us. I have so many questions. What we're going to do is I will pose a few of them to you. I know that you've got some sections set up that we're going to hear from the book. And then if we're going to keep the crowd on mute during the event proper, but people can send us their questions in the chat. And in the later part of the event, we will turn to those and do a bit of Q&A to get a sense of what burning audience questions there are. And then uniquely this evening, after the event proper, we're going to leave the event open for a chance to socialize informally and chat with Sarah and air all of your thoughts and opinions. That bit will be off record. We'll let that be a special event for this evening. But Sarah, first of all, my classic question is, where was the seed of The Raven's Nest? What was the seed of this book that initiated the book?
Well, first of all, I'd like to thank you very much, Will, for having me and for this amazing the tiniest bookshop you can imagine that's in Grasmere, which, for anyone who doesn't know, is where Dorothy and William Wordsworth lived and wrote together. And I walked into that bookshop one day in 2013 when I was on a journey on foot for Penguin Books, that was a kind of a project linked to Robert McFarlane's book called The Old Ways. And I suppose in some ways the germ of being a writer was on that journey. You know, it's sort of the experience of living in Iceland for the period between 2008 and 2014, or that's at least the period that the book takes, but this was 2013. And I was in a situation where I knew that my marriage was definitely coming to an end, and I needed a way to sort of transfigure that experience into something generative. But I wasn't yet a writer, and that journey did a lot to sort of, I don't know, walk me towards something where I could develop a creative practice to do something with the experience, not just emotional, but of everything that I learned from living in the subarctic and the Arctic. So I think the germs of creative endeavor kind of happen without necessarily you being conscious of them. But I know that walking remains a practice that helps me a lot to kind of bring things into being. Yeah. And I walked into Sam Reed's and we've been friends ever since. And here we are.
And that was a fantastic project as well, that Wayfinder project. That we'd heard about the project before we encountered you. We knew from Penguin that they were going to be asking for someone to do this. So it was great to see who had got the gig essentially too. But a wonderful faith in, I suppose, allowing people to, someone in that role, in your role, to respond to walking and writing at a time when the nature writing boom was kind of at its beginning in the UK too, it felt, you know, that off the back of that project, that was a really interesting time to begin writing. So did you ever think at that point though that this would become a book, in that kind of sketching out a future where you were responding to what you've been through? Was it your aim from the beginning that you would like it to be a book?
Not at all, no. The whole time that I lived in Iceland, I had no intention or idea that I would write a book. It was more that, I mean, one of the threads of this book is that I'm an ethnographic filmmaker who fails to make a film because of the problematization that I encountered of being somebody who was also in love with somebody and with the place. And my training had taught me to try and be somewhat objective, and I just wasn't finding that hiding behind a camera was working in terms of integrating into a remote community. So that is one of the threads. And I think it was not, I guess because I was trying to make a film and failing, the memories seemed to record stronger in my mind. So years later when I started writing, it was as if I had these sort of rushes. Rushes is the film name for raw footage. It's as if I'd shot them with my eyes and I could draw on them. So I have a lot of footage and a lot of photographs, but I didn't actually refer to them to write this book. It's just they're sort of strongly lodged in my memory. Mm. Yeah.
And I'm really fascinated by the dimensions of this book, which filmmaking brings as well, because it's obviously such a part of how you've conjured the project and a part of your being in practice going into your experience of living and being in Iceland. And hopefully we'll kind of turn to that as we get into conversation. But I wonder whether it might be useful to begin with a reading from the book to get a sense of what we're talking about.
Sure. And I'm just actually going to just open with the opening of the book because it feels disingenuous to do otherwise, not the whole thing. But there's obviously a label called nature writing, which every person who's called a nature writer seems to also resist, because the argument being, you know, if we are, as we're arguing, a part of nature, then to label it nature writing only serves to separate us. You know, all writing should be nature writing. But I am happy to call this ecological memoir because it both deals with ecology and the ecological crisis without naming it as such, but also because it's ecological in its nature, in that I've written it in a way that everything relates to everything else. Mm. And so you get a sense of there being this thrumming web that tugs at other points in the book. And as it builds, you start noticing the connections, as I did, as I lived there. Mm. But also in a place like Iceland, dynamic as it is, those connections are constantly being rumbled. So this is chapter one. Breaking up. August 2014. I'm sitting in the kitchen of my old corrugated ironclad house. Underneath me, 800 kilometers to the southeast, the earth has been breaking up since the evening I parked up out front one long week ago. I arrived as the day dimmed, relieved to have the hours of rock and sea and fog behind me, months of anticipation giving way to reality. Then, 8 kilometers under the ground, below a distant glacier, unseen but detected by geologists and their myriad instruments, a tremor swarm began. I heard about it on the radio the next morning as the late summer sun poured in through the large windows. There had been 250 earthquakes during the night. When the news broke, I laughed at the consistency with which my comings and goings between England and Iceland seemed to coincide precisely with weather changes and volcanic activity. The eruption of Eyjafjallajökull, the Icelandic volcano that nobody could pronounce, which closed European airspace in 2010, was preceded by a lesser known smaller eruption on Fimbulhaus. That had begun the day I arrived in March 2010 and ended the day I left with the eruption of Eyjafjallajökull. I had been on one of the last flights for many days, separated from my husband by a cloud of ash. Now, each day there are earthquakes, and a crack has grown from 50 kilometers long in a week, still invisible as it rips below Vatnajökull, the largest glacier in the country. Every day, almost every hour from 7 a.m. till 10 p.m., the radio news announces the latest earthquakes, usually in the region of 1,000 a day now, the strongest recently reaching 5.7 on the Richter scale. I hang on every word, pretty sure an eruption will follow, and not knowing whether I should prepare myself to leave before I risk getting stuck here. The first few days of this trip were difficult. My destination, clarity in an uncertain marriage, is far from guaranteed. I have mostly been here alone, well, with my cat, and a brief but intense lifetime of memories of this place to process, some dark, some joyful. This house and I felt asynchronous when I walked in. It looked much the same as it did when I left all those months ago. I had asked my husband, Bjarni, for our cat to be here when I returned. He made sure he was at the house when I arrived and was cooking lamb in the kitchen, almost like nothing had ever happened. The only visible evidence of time passing was a few kind notes from tourists who had come and enjoyed this thing we had created, while we did not live in it ourselves, this bohemian Arctic hideaway, this romantic retreat, while we had tried to figure out how and where we could live together and failed. I feel the need to do something physical and aesthetic to mark the change. In front of me, I peel decades of wallpaper, Hessian, and old newspaper from the walls in my study to get back to the bare bones of this place, this wooden kit house from Norway, erected in 1902. We know the name of the person who erected it, and that his son's wife lived in it for 70 years before we became the current owners. It may be that couple's history I'm peeling away now to reveal the time-darkened honey-colored pine paneling it was made with before it became fashionable to mask it with paper. A well-traveled wood, for there were no trees here big enough to build with. The final layer is the Weekly Scotsman, 19th of June, 1909. How did that newspaper end up in this house just below the Arctic Circle? Old news, which one day mine shall also be. Trees, wood, paper, words, they vanish as they form. Old news, which one day this imminent eruption shall be, whether it happens or not. For now, I try to embrace the Icelandic way and take each day as it comes, to stay put and do what I came here to do. The international news recalls the chaos caused by the 2010 volcano that nobody could pronounce. Juliana, my old boss from the flower shop, dismisses these tremors as a media sensation. I enjoy her humanizing of this seismic activity, the suggestion that somehow it is a protracted form of attention grabbing, like a celebrity affair. My neighbor Maya tells me, there's nothing you can do but wait and see. It's the same as driving a car in a big city. Sure, something might happen, but that doesn't stop you from driving.
That's wonderful. Thank you, Sarah. I suppose kind of off the back of our talking about the book and how you go about describing it, one of the interesting things people then might encounter, even from this introduction, is to think about its sense of time. And I'm curious as to know, how did you come about with a structure that isn't chronological? It's about a window of time, but it's not from 2008 to 2014 in order. How did you kind of decide on a kind of nested structure that you landed?
Well, I think the reason I did this was the creative component of the PhD in interdisciplinary studies. And the reason I wanted to do it as a PhD was because it's only in that context that you would have the time to explore something so that it would reveal itself to me. Whereas if you go the publishing route directly, where you find an agent and then you sell a book on the basis of a proposal, you're asked to write basically, you know, a structure and chapter summaries, and you're allowed to change it afterwards. But I'm a strong believer in once something's committed to paper, it has a strong kind of echo to it. And so I didn't even want to do that process of like drafting a structure. And so it really was an act of revelation where it was literally a case of just sometimes a chapter would come to me, you know, there'd be a certain theme or a certain object that I would start with. For example, one of the chapters called Seal Wife, that it talks about a quartz pebble beach that I mean, I don't want to do spoiler alert, but, you know, essentially got cleared and turned from a magical place into one of exploitation. But my ex-husband had sent me pebbles, quartz pebbles from that beach, and I'd been looking for them in a box in my studio, and then I found them and I just had them in my hands. And then suddenly these memories started coming back, and I just sat and wrote the chapter there and then, holding these two quartz pebbles. And that is the one chapter that I haven't hardly touched, and it's quite remarkable. I think that probably happens once or twice in a writer's life that you're actually gifted a chapter. And then other times it was just, I guess, you know, one writing one thing would prompt another memory, and I just wrote things out as they came. And then the structure revealed itself very late on. I mean, my PhD supervisor is here, who will tell me, you know, I was trying to impose a very different metaphor on, and it just wasn't working. And suddenly we're like, it's the nest. That's what this is. Mm. And so there's a lot of threads of themes going on, and the nest gives the structure, you know, allows you to weave those threads. And the thing that I was definitely doing was following not so much a chronology, but a cyclicality of time through the cycles of light and dark, because the Arctic is all about that, you know, that there's nothing else. It's light and dark makes life happen or not.
Mm. Mm. And that's I think that's one of the wonderful things that strikes you about the reading of the book, is that you do have these very vivid experiences in each section, and they're not, as they might be in another book, sort of a collection of essays. They are interwoven and reaching out to each other for themes and motifs. And so the only thing I can think that might have been very difficult in construction is to think of the reader fresh to this book, who is going to be trying to pick up the first time we encounter people, and the kind of thing you have as almost as a novelist to introduce characters and recall them. And I thought it was really, there's a really deft gesture here to our kind of early awareness of figures who become more prominent in your life. Even as you say there, that the florist who's commenting on the earthquakes and their perception of the earthquakes, that we get the story of the florists later in the book, but it's lovely to have it foreshadowed, because you feel like you're meeting a friend as you see them. You've had their existence flagged up to you early on. And there are very few books that can do that. So it's a really interesting approach that this takes. Was there a resistance to, like you say, that if you came up with a plan, you'd be tied into that plan. But did you feel like that would have been a more kind of artificial way of writing your story, to have essentially kind of programmed it out like that? Was that part Definitely. Of what you think?
Yeah, I mean, I think this is a sort of very decolonial and more than human-led project as well. Like, I absolutely didn't want to be imposing myself or anything kind of... Yeah, I think I had a very strong experience of the natural world in Iceland being an incredibly potent force, of which I was a part, but, you know, it was a reciprocal relationship, and I wanted to take my cue from nature more. And so I noticed as well that a lot of the way that the kind of storytelling that I enjoy is a cycle of time that you can kind of jump on at any point and jump off at any point, and it's sort of an ongoing cycle. And I hope that even though this is complex, you don't experience it as complex. It's sort of, you can actually, you can start reading from the middle and keep mm-hmm. going, and then come back around to that chapter that you started at. Theoretically, that should also work, because each chapter, even though, like you say, it's not exactly an essay that's self-contained, they are somewhat, they're like vignettes, I would say, rather than essays, you know. So they're vignettes that, and it's very filmic. And I think it's partly because you've seen certain places and landscapes as well. And so you can then start to place people. But I had a raven living in the vicinity. I mean, there's many ravens. It's been great to be back with them. I hope you saw my tweet of today. I was just like, oh, thank you, raven. You're just making an announcement for me. And they're very tatty there, and they're just all over the place. You know, you don't have to climb a mountain to see them. They're just like above the supermarket, just doing all these cool sounds. And I had a raven who lived very close to me, and who used to come and tap on the roof if I didn't put bones out for him, because the woman who lived in the house for 70 years before us, she'd always fed it. And so it became our responsibility of guardians of the house to keep feeding the raven. And so, you know, raven became quite a strong, I don't want to call raven a motif. Raven's so much more than a motif. Raven's everything. My dedication in the front of the book is, I'll just read it out. to the ravens for making, unmaking, and remaking the world, and for the light, always the light. So yeah, when I found the raven's nest is actually a real nest that I encountered quite late in my time there. And it just blew me away because it was a very complex structure about a meter wide that appeared to be quite raggedy, but was also very intricate and complex. And it got more intricate towards the center, but it contained everything. It contained, you know, sheep shoulder blade, a rake, a TV aerial, some fishing net, like branches. And it's because there's no trees for it to entangle in. So it has to be weighty so that it can survive the storms. And so this raven who built that nest had just gone and used all of this human kind of technology to make its own home more robust. And I thought that was a lovely metaphor of kind of interspecies living. Mm-hmm. And so that came later as the title. But then I realized, and also there's a lovely kind of incidental linguistic thing where, as a filmmaker, the raw footage that you shoot, as I said, it's called rushes, and obviously rushes are also like a kind of plant matter that birds use to weave nests with. So in my thesis, I talked about being left with an armful of rushes that I didn't know what to do with, and so I wove them into a nest. Yeah,
and there must be, as there is, I suppose, for the raven, there's a sense that there's some kind of structure that's intended. There's an improvised aim, there's improvised in terms of gathering materials and working out what works, but I wonder how much that the threat of having too many angles, the kind of the space and time challenge it poses to construct something as you've done, whether it led to you thinking of something central or central issues that you wanted to keep returning to make sure that you had the material that was part of the nest, because in someone else's hands you could end up feeling like you had a patchwork quilt that wasn't all there, or something which didn't kind of weave together. It wasn't the carrier bag that brought everything together. So how did you kind of sense what to leave in and what to leave out? What's that selection process been like for you in terms of writing about place and time through the book?
In some ways I feel like the book sort of wrote itself inside my body first, and then all I had to do was show up to the page. All I had to do, but you know, so there was less conscious kind of, you know, what should I leave in, what should I leave out. It's more like in terms of feeling, it's like representing the feeling of an accumulation of knowledge through immersion in a place. And so I take the reader on the journey with me. You're not sort of looking at it from the outside. You're sort of accumulating these bits of knowledge and accumulating paradoxes as well. I think that was the biggest, strongest experience for me in Iceland, was that you have to inhabit paradox on a daily basis. I mean, for example, I remember in one of my PhD, you have to have an annual review. And I think the guy who was examining me was saying, you know, everyone's all down on binaries these days, and but you know, you do have opposites. And I said, well, you know, and I said, like what? And he goes, well, like light and dark. And I was like, no, they can both exist, you know. I said, for example, I used to sit outside on my front doorstep in the winter time reading under the light of the full moon, because it was brighter during the day, brighter during the night than during the day. And you know, that's, for me, that's a beautiful, it's an exquisite kind of paradox. But that kind of stuff is happening all the time. So it allowed me to think differently. It was a place that picked apart my entrenched ways of thinking and has made me much more open to the unknown. Yeah.
And so I suppose in that, then the subject of the book then is filtered through you and your experiences. And I think it's really interesting that kind of the way that we learn along with you, even to the extent that that late in book discovery of the nest is there with us when we encounter it too. Mm-hmm. But then I think it's really interesting to work with the idea that you are the subject of the book as much as Iceland, and your encounter with place is a part of that. So how did you kind of navigate your own relationship with yourself in terms of that process? You were the cipher, you were the way that we experience the stories and your kind of learning process. So how difficult was it to be, I guess, subject and object of your own writing in that way too?
Yeah, very difficult. I think that was the most challenging part, because obviously that, you know, there's me sort of 5 years on from the living of the experience. And so I'm trying to capture a narrator who is still aged, what was I, 28 to 32 sort of thing. But I was writing it as a 37-year-old, and quite a lot dawns on you in your 30s, where, you know, I sort of would look back and go, God, that was a bit naive, or maybe that's not Iceland, maybe that's just life, you know. Mm-hmm. So I had to be willing to be vulnerable, you know, I had to be willing to be somebody that I might cringe at, but to be clear that I'm learning as we're learning. And I think that was the biggest thing for me, and my resistance to sort of the anthropological self that I'd previously been professionally. I just felt like it was much more authentic to be able to show up in a place where I too was at stake, and, you know, to be vulnerable and to be learning together with other people, and to learn from them and hope that they might want to learn something, or hope that I had something as well, not just a one-way thing. And I've noticed, though, that another big detail is that once I had left or was leaving Iceland and didn't need anything from it anymore, it revealed itself in a whole new way. Mm. Yeah, so it's been a very different relationship that I've had with it from 2015 onwards. I felt much more of a fluent sense of not trying to belong anymore. We just do. Yeah.
And so there must have been, I mean, it must have been interesting, just having recently returned, to talk about this book in the place that you have developed a lived relationship with, a written relationship with, and then returned with the product of it to that place. I mean, how was that for you?
It was amazing. It was completely amazing. And obviously it was a very risky thing to do, because I didn't know how it'd be received, but it just felt like the only thing to do. I didn't want to be someone who just took from a place and then showed it over here. And I wanted to put myself in a position where I was reading back to the people who are in the book. And I think, I did some lovely readings that were very well attended, considering it's like high holiday season in places that are fairly, you know, low population. We had like 15 to 20 people at least in each reading. And I even did some private readings for ex-family members and the farmer, Adelstein, who's in this. I did one, you know, one-on-one with him, and he was so chuffed. He kind of realized that he's now been in three different things, like a DVD and a book and then another picture book, and he sort of lined them all up and took a picture of all his his things. It's really sweet. And I feel like it's renewed my relationship with certain people. It's done a lot of, it's strong medicine. That's what I've experienced it as. I'm really happy with it. And I'm just so happy I'm getting sent pictures of people out there who bought it, who are sitting reading it right now. And it's amazing.
And there is that really interesting visual component to it too, because again, you interweave with the writing these fantastic images of landscape. How important was that to you? Again, because if you propose that to a publisher from the get-go, they may be very resistant to seeing sort of visual woven with written. What did that mean for you to put those images within the project?
You know what, I'm so glad that I don't come from a literary background, because I wasn't aware of it. I just did what felt right to me, and I didn't know that I was being genre traversing, because I didn't know what genres there were. I just wrote this thing coming from the perspective of a filmmaker who has an anthropological background and who falls in love with a place and a guy and a house. And it was kind of as simple as that. So I'm delighted when people say they don't know where to place this, but I also want to say, just shake it up a bit, guys. Why all the walls, you know? But sorry, what was the question? I've just forgotten.
It's really about the importance of those images to you. Yeah.
Very important. I mean, I think it's aesthetically, or I don't even want to call it aesthetically, because the senses are all engaged all at once there. It's not only visual, but it's such a mind-blowing landscape that it would be very strange to write about Iceland in a way that you couldn't see it. Somehow it would miss the point. And I think I'm sort of using the landscape a lot, and objects, natural objects, to talk about bigger issues. You know, I'm using them metaphorically quite often. So I think it's quite clear to precisely, it's important to precisely describe what it is and how it looks. And not just what it is and how it looks, but what is in it in terms of, for example, I'm quite obsessed with guillemot eggs. Anyone who knows me well will know that I've got a collection of these beautiful, very tall sort of pyriform eggs that captivated me since I first went there. And I had various encounters with guillemot eggs in different ways, including eating them. But then later found out that they were toxic because of PCBs and ocean plastic pollution. And so, you know, it's not just what's visible. You can have something that's aesthetically very beautiful, but it holds within it the problems of the world. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's another fantastic example, isn't it, of containing different binaries and suspending them because they've got such a kind of traditional affinity for you, and yet you find out the environmental cost of those. Mm-hmm. And there are many, many points like that too, I think, throughout, where we learn with you about your kind of response and layering of information about the landscape. Another one being, I suppose, the kind of the tourism, the impact of tourism. Your first job is in terms of responding to the need for supplying tourists at the end of a walk with sustenance, and yet your own relationship with tourism changes, would it be fair to say, throughout the book too?
Definitely. I mean, I think the kind of tourism that was going on at the point, so the first tourism experience I had was managing an old vintage school bus that was a shop on a campsite that's at the end of a world famous hiking route called the Lögavegur. And it's on a campsite that looks like it's kind of on the moon, if the moon was a bit more colourful. And there's a beautiful, huge hot spring there. And this shop had been started by friends of mine and Hughes there. And they'd been running it for 12 years, but it's a shop that had evolved to the needs of the visitors and also to an environmental issue that was happening nearby, which was that some Arctic char had been released into a nearby lake. And because there was no competing species, it had got out of control, and the government was actively encouraging people to go and fish the lake. And so one of my ex-husband's uncles became the fisherman of that lake and would bring the fresh fish to the campsite and sell it to campers. And obviously when you've been eating pot noodles for the past 5 days, suddenly finding fresh fish is just delightful. My lasting legacy was inventing fish burgers on that campsite. But that was still felt kind of in control. That didn't feel like mass tourism. It felt like it was quite a big number of people, but mountain lovers, you know, who were coming to do quite a hardcore hiking route. But now it's just a whole other thing. I mean, it's gone insane. I just can't even, there's a lot of cruise ship tourism happening now, which I just don't think is really good for anything, because they disgorge onto a place that's quite remote, kind of use the toilets, don't really buy anything, and then leave again. And you suddenly, in a place like Ísafjörður that's got a population of maybe 2,600, you might have more than double the population of the place emptying off one boat or two boats in a day. But at the same time, nobody's impervious to greed there. You know, at the same time, people are raking in the money, some people. So there's this sort of ambivalent relationship with it. Like, it's now become the main industry. It's displaced fishing as the main industry in Iceland. And I'm not quite sure what's going to happen when the bubble bursts. Mm-hmm. But Icelanders are really good at, like, something always works itself out. But this one does feel quite damaging. But then equally, the alternative being mooted back when I first moved there was capturing the power of most of the rivers and waterfalls for hydropower for aluminium, American aluminium smelting companies to come and get cheap energy. So there could also have been an industrial revolution, which is, you know, arguably worse.
Mm. And those kind of lived experiences of a place, they come across powerfully located in the book. But as you say, with the kind of cruise ship tourism, or indeed you kind of that first introduction to being in the converted school bus shop, you know, they're almost a species of space in general, a species of space around the world that's going through similar kind of dynamics. So I like the way that there were connections between what you discussed that are very specific to Iceland, and particularly language, culture, attitude. And yet, you know, back in the Lake District here, we have many of the same dynamics at play about how these places retain some quality of place and environment and respond to those pressures that industry and economics places upon them. So, and I know that you have that kind of doubling by writing about Iceland while you were back in Cumbria. Mm-hmm. Do you feel like those connections were a really helpful thing to build, that they could inform each other, there'd be some kind of global learning through understanding the similarities of pressures upon precious places?
Yeah, and I don't think it's just sort of because obviously Cumbria and Iceland share this sort of Norse heritage. I just think it's mass tourism in general. You know, there's something very precious and particular vernacular to a place that makes it appealing and beguiling, and people come to see that thing, and then that thing starts to become commodified, and then it becomes commodified on a massive scale, and then suddenly the soul is hollowed out of it. I mean, I think one way I could illustrate that is with the Icelandic jumpers, which, you know, everyone had an Icelandic jumper, and it's like all women and a lot of men also knit and learn to knit in school. And so, you know, in the wintertime, everyone's knitting all the time, and everyone owns a log pacer because it works. It's like the perfect thing for the weather there. But then, you know, people started spotting them. And then there was these sort of Scandi Noir detective series where there was some very cool jumpers, and they became like a fashion item. And now they're selling for a lot of money. Even the secondhand ones, you used to be able to pick up a secondhand one for sort of 20, 30 quid. And now the secondhand ones are selling for 200 quid. And you get people knitting really bad ones. You get them being made in China. You know, and this has all happened in about 5 years. It's changed, or maybe 8 years. But yeah, I mean, if I had bought a load of charity shop Icelandic jumpers and actually just kept them in a box for a while, I'd have my pension taken care of by now. It's crazy. But that's what, yeah. And so then the thing that was really, that had a story to each person, and there were different designs according to different regions. And yeah, it just feels, and now you've got a lot of these people that would have been knitting for their family are furiously knitting all winter to sell them in the summer. Although I did encounter something very sweet on my little Westfield tour. I popped in to visit some people who ran, you remember the waffle place on the fjord where you saw the seals from, anyone who came to my wedding, the little buyer, the greenhouse. So Sigga and Bubbi, they now knit together all winter. They're getting old, but like she does the pattern bit and he does the plain bit, and they make a jumper together, and they made 55 last winter, and they've already sold them all. And they're just like, what, you know? So it's like, where do you draw the line? But yeah, it's a pretty pension.
And those decisions that you, yeah, didn't know that you could have made back then in the wake of the kind of financial crash as well, that things that you would never have imagined would be, yeah, a store for the future. If people could keep their questions coming in, we've got one in the chat, we'll get to it, and people should pop them in. If there's anything that you'd like to ask Sarah, we'll certainly move to that. One of the things I was also wondering is, in terms of some of those stories, you know, the kind of environmental cost is there around the pressures on the landscape. But you also have this really interesting relationship whereby you're trying to capture for us and for yourself what's of value in tradition, what's of value in people's community ways, in crafts, as you're pointing to there. And I wonder how difficult it was maybe to navigate that whilst being there in person. You know, it's almost the anthropological question again, to work out how you appraise and value craft in the moment beyond, you know, if we're going to talk about beyond long-term value and what becomes overly reified. In the book, you're quite careful, I think, to discuss when you're observing folk ways, community ways and traditions. And Do you still kind of retain a sense of kind of awe and intrigue at those things that kind of still exist in Iceland, the kind of cultural attachments, the threads through time that those folkways present now?
Definitely. I said maybe I wouldn't call it awe so much as just sort of, a quite fierce defense of them. I feel like it's a kind of language that we will need again. So it's not awe in the sense of, oh my gosh, that's amazing. And I'm so interested. It's more like, gosh, this needs writing down, because this comes out of years of living with something, and it evolves out of that. So yeah, I think once you cut that off, that experience of living with, it's very hard to kind of, if there's a gap in the generations where there's like a generation where that didn't happen, and then we reach another difficult time, which arguably we're reaching, it's not easy to figure it out all over again. So I feel like there's a generation that is on its way out who are this sort of knowledge keepers and culture bearers of a certain way of life that is of hardship, where they found comfort and creativity within hardship, that is very important. Yeah.
I also wonder whether that might be a nice lead in to talking about the next piece from the book that we had prepared.
Yeah, it would actually, wouldn't it? Yeah. So one of the other sort of pulses of the structure is every year the sheep are let out in the summer and roam free in the mountains, and every October they're gathered in on foot. And in the particular fjord where my ex's family had sheep, and when I say family, I mean like an auntie had a flock of 200, and then all the neighboring farmers and their extended family gather together for a weekend to help gather in the sheep on foot. And because it's so steep, the mountains where they were, there's no sheepdogs, there's no quad bikes, it's just a team of people on foot. And that happens every year. And then the slaughter of them happens a couple of weeks after that. Obviously a lot are sent off to a slaughterhouse, but there's some slaughtering that goes on just for personal consumption as well. and so I was involved in that a few times. And I'm going to, the first couple of times that I was involved with it, I wanted to just participate and watch so that I would know what I would then film, because I thought you can't just turn up and film a thing. And I also felt like I needed to understand the language a bit better. So this takes place on the sort of, three years in to my being there. And we are at a house that's like a halfway point. The gathering happens over a weekend. This is where we are on the night of the first day. No ghost to report, I interject into the silence, pouring myself a cup of coffee. No, Hiramia didn't pay you a visit, Hoika inquires with a half smile. He slurps at his mug of silver tea. A mixture of milk and hot water. I remember the first time I came here, Hoika proudly showed me with a gap-toothed half smile, the bedroom upstairs in which he was conceived and born. The bedroom in which, he told me, the ghost of a criminal named Marius appeared at the end of his mother's bed and threatened to haunt her if she did not name her child after him. Hoika Marius Gudmundsson. He grew up in this house, and Hiramia was a farmhand who lived and died here. How she died, nobody has told me. There is a beguiling black and white photograph of her upstairs, a beautiful young woman perched playfully on a dry stone wall. She is wrapped in a woolen shawl, her infinite dark braid hanging over her right shoulder like a ladder between earth and sky. She is said to haunt this house. Last night, I slept in the room next to Hiramia Herbergi to see what would happen. I wonder whether the door of her room in the attic is locked to keep people out or her ghost in. I had a dream, though, I say, reaching for a pancake. Adelstein's eyebrows lift above his glasses. No, what happened? We were sheep gathering, but in the sea, in shallow waters. No. Either chuckles from her perch beside the range. It is an exclamation that always strikes me as the sound that eider ducks make as they bob around on the wavelets, especially the way she says it. The seabed was lined with newspaper pages in black and white. Hoiker was telling us to pick up all the pages that had pictures on them and cut them out. Hoiker chuckles and gets up to go to the bathroom. Then, Bjarni and I were lying in deeper water on our backs, and behind him, a little distance away, I saw a whale breach. I thought, if that jumps, there's going to be a huge swell where we are. And suddenly Bjarni froze and told me there was a massive whale's eye right behind my head. Then I woke up. Nu ja, ja, Adelstein chirps, stroking his moustache into place with his thumb and forefinger. I don't usually remember dreams, but this one was particularly vivid. We are on a sheep gathering mission, and yesterday we were accompanied up the fjord by the exhalations of a humpback whale. So it might seem an obvious set of solid images for my subconscious to dissolve into a dreamscape. But I wonder about the newspapers and the foregrounded nature of the whale's eye. Adelstein leans forward onto his elbows with interlocked fingers, circling his thumbs around each other, a characteristic tick that others impersonate in jest. His dark grey eyebrows furrow into serious reflection. The newspaper pages indicate that something of historical significance is happening, and water means trouble. I sit down in front of him, delighted. Not only is he a farmer poet, he's a dream interpreter as well. And the large eye means something is watching over you, looking out for your mistakes. Probably your father-in-law. It is a relief to have such a connection made by a third party. Nobody can argue with an allegory. Ha, Poker bellows, striding back into the kitchen. Are you talking about me? Poker is characterized by a kind of shyness that prevents him ever revealing his feelings explicitly or engaging readily in conversation with people he does not know extremely well, of whom I am one and will remain so until we have a shared history. Despite this shyness, I have found that Hoiko loves being the center of attention within his own element. It was made startlingly clear yesterday. I have waited 2 years, two farming cycles, to film the sheep gathering in which Bjarni and his family participate. I have wanted to learn Icelandic, to build relationships with those involved and to participate fully as a gatherer myself before attempting to document it. The main character was supposed to be Adelstein, the owner of the majority of the flock. But Hoiker has seen to it that he is the star of the show, striding into the frame with entertaining antics and wry jokes, which eclipse Adelstein's gangling and introspective demeanor. I don't mind. A character is a character after all. But it has left me wondering, as I often have, what story I am telling, whose story I am telling. Adelstein is someone to be quiet with, who slowly reveals himself through his thoughts and movements. Hoiker is the storyteller, the joker, the player, who saunters into situations like a man who thinks he knows best. Even though I am behind the camera and not a character, my involvement with this place and with these people does not allow me to be an invisible observer. I'm embedded in their dynamics. As I filmed Adelstein arriving yesterday, removing his wellies lined with carrier bags. Of course he greeted me and congratulated me on our wedding. Of course I responded. Hoiker knows me well enough not to need words to draw me into his narrative. I am beginning to realize I still need to know who I am before I know which story I am telling. Am I talking about Hoiker? No, I smile inwardly. We're talking about a whale.
That's wonderful. Thank you, Sarah. I think there's something interesting, and maybe this actually feeds into some of the questions we've been talking about, but also the first question that Sarah here has posed, which is to ask how Icelandic culture then differed from your own experiences that you had before living there, because those are very much kind of moments of encounter. Did you find that, you know, there was a kind of a culture apart that you were having to learn in this?
Yeah, and especially to do with dreams and the supernatural, and not at all wanting to make out that, you know, Icelanders are super kooky or anything, but just that sense of there being something beyond the material realm, something beyond that we can sense. That's kind of almost my experience, is that it's approached as a kind of given, so that the world is animate. And definitely I did have, I wouldn't say I'm somebody who did or didn't believe in ghosts before Iceland, but I have had several experiences with ghosts now where I couldn't say that I don't believe in them now. It's just, it was so clear and so backed up by what other people were seeing. And I remember one of the ghosts was the woman who'd lived in my house for 70 years. You know, her presence was definitely still in the house, but not in a malevolent way, unless something was awry. In that case, she expressed her displeasure. But I remember the first time I had this experience with a ghost. Bjarni was at sea on a trawler, and I just needed to tell somebody. And I think I had to go and do some admin down in town. And so I told the woman in like the job center or something, you know, somebody who was suited and booted. I just sort of blurted it out, like, I've got a ghost in my house. And she just said, oh God, mine gets really angry if I go on holiday and don't talk to him about it first. You know, it's just like he was an alcoholic and he died and we have to have a bit of a negotiation. But like, you know, and I can't believe this woman in a suit is just like not only was she not surprised at my story, but she's got her own. And that has been really commonplace. Yeah.
So those kinds of cultural assumptions you make are really interesting in that moment, aren't they? That you're meeting a different script, you're meeting a different way of living with and in the world.
Yeah.
And so another question actually kind of maybe chimes with some of this. James has asked here, what positive aspect of the nature of your relationships with Icelandic people have you found most hard to find in the UK or miss the most?
Huh, that's a very interesting question and very sort of live topic, actually, having just come back from there. I think it's directness, and that's why I fitted so well, because people tell me I'm very un-British and it's like, I'll have that, frankly. But like, yeah, I think the directness of Icelandic ways of, you know, if they don't want to do something, they just say, nope, there's no skirting around it. And so you kind of know where you stand, and you can see why that's evolved, because it's like, you just need to get something done, you know, need to have the clarity of communication. I'm less keen on the sort of profound economy of language, you know, it's just sometimes it's just talking just doesn't happen when it really should. I don't miss that at all. Expressing emotions, that's not a cool, that's very common, but it's not very cool. I think spontaneity also, I just love. I mean, this tour that I've just been on, anyone who's been following me on Twitter would have thought that maybe I put months of planning into that. I didn't, and I knew that I was sort of pulling my hair out trying to organize stuff, but I know in my heart that it's only when I show up and go, hey, it's me, so how about tomorrow, that stuff happens. Icelanders are incredibly good at like leaving it to the absolute last, and then even not even necessarily doing much about it, but things just sort of work themselves out. And they have an expression, tetaredast, which was the first words I learned. Tetaredast means it will work itself out. It's not, and it doesn't involve like agency in the sense we talk about agency, where it's our doing, it's our doing something in relationship with chance. That's what tetaredast is about. You know, be very open to things you couldn't have planned. Yeah.
That, again, that's fantastic. And the thought comes across as well, like the discussion you have about perceptions of landscape and the view, even from the Norwegian house, the sense that you're quite keen on the idea of, maybe at one point you discuss having trees and there's this kind of disruption, the idea that trees would disrupt the landscape. Actually, it's much better if we can just see down the way, and people would be like, they would maybe comment on the idea of reintroducing trees would be a very contradictory thing to do.
Well, I just one of the unexpected things that happened at one of my readings, which happened to be at the former home of the sort of leader of the 19th century independence movement in Iceland. You know, I didn't expect to get to do a reading there, but I did. And in the audience was an archaeologist who'd been leading some very important digs just in the neighboring farm, that they found a potentially settlement story changing site. And where am I going with this? Sorry, what was the question again?
About perceptions of landscape, that trees might interrupt it. You know.
Yeah. So she took us on the tour of this site, which involves, you know, a kind of what looks to be a sweat lodge slash women's weaving room all at the same time. But there's also been a tree planting project going on. And like the trees, the birch trees are starting to creep down the hill. And she's just like, oh, I hate trees. They just ruin archaeology. You know, there's probably another Viking longhouse in that forest. And now we're not going to. And she's like, you're supposed to be able to see the view. So, yeah, there's some real tree haters there.
Again, those different kind of conceptions of value, I think, are really interesting that you document within the book in a really lived way.
Yeah, but equally, that it used to be forested. This idea that it was always this bare land is not accurate either. You know, the settlers did a really good job of deforesting it. So it's like, you know, this thing of how many generations back do you go to get what the baseline was?
Yeah.
And obviously sheep have done a good job of it as well.
So many tensions. And actually, one of the next questions we have here from Paul is there's a tension that you identify between the natural and the need to make money so well, in terms of the quartz beach, trip to the quartz, and those sold across ethnic shops in the world. Love that you didn't brush over those issues, but was there any pressure to romanticize the natural experience?
Pressure from who?
doesn't say here, but I wonder, you know, if you felt any pressure in terms of representing Iceland, or in terms of representing your kind of writing project, what you were doing, whether there was a tendency to do that even.
No, I think I needed to wait until in myself I knew the complexities. And I suppose also that, like you say, the nature writing scene was quite new at that time. And I still felt like a lot of times it was still quite safe and polished and wasn't kind of drawing out these threads of how damaged things were. But at the same time, not wanting to be, I didn't want it to be grief stricken entirely. You know, I wanted to hold space for the grief of a damaged world, but for it not to feel like this heavy thing. I wanted to create a space within which people could fall in love with that landscape as well, and not just to feel the wounds of the world. And also I kind of comment on how, to my eyes, that quartz beach still had quartz pebbles on it and looked really beautiful and pristine. But to Bjarni's eyes, who had seen it completely covered in quartz pebbles, which sung when the waves washed over it and which sparked in the dark, you know, it's like the normalization, what we consider normal. I was actually thinking about that as I landed today and I saw just how parched Hyde Park, for example, was. And I'm looking out at the Heathrow thinking, God, you know, this is awful. But if a child saw this, they wouldn't know that that wasn't normal. And so each generation, we normalize something different. And so it's like, is it our position to kind of, you know, what do we do for children, actually? Because we don't want them to just be born into a world of grief. But at the same time, you know, we need to understand what a functioning ecosystem actually looks like, a healthy one, not just functioning, but healthy.
And it's really interesting, even where the discussion of sheep gathering goes in the book too, the notion of that tradition with all of its complexities and problems, and how, you know, generational shift means that it's maybe not the kind of work that you are inclined to do anymore, that there are, you know, better ways of spending your time that seem less like mimicking the work of a sheepdog on Icelandic landscape in a family gathering all thrown together at the same time. So
yeah, I'm definitely not so into what sheep do to the landscape. I think they create a lot of erosion, but I can see that way of gathering the sheep and then, you know, having the meat that you get gifted for participating in the roundup, and then all of the meals then are also shared. So it's an incredible social glue, that whole practice. And also it's one that connects those people with that place and that landscape very intimately. Like they have names for every single little hollow so that they can walkie-talkie to one another saying, I've seen one here. Mm-hmm. So it's like, you know, I worry that if you stopped doing the sheep farming, which might be good for the landscape, but then would there be any connection? Like, where, yeah, what's this middle place that we haven't yet found our way with?
So the kind of intimacy of practice in the place, but also of knowledge. It's a genuine calendar moment, isn't it, for people to be present with each other and to perform that role. There's a lot that comes out of just necessitated gathering, it seems. But also, which is there in the kind of Christmases you document too, it's really interesting to get kind of Christmas traditions in the country put forward too as gathering times.
Exactly, yeah. And the tongue. Yeah, you'll get to that bit.
curious foodstuffs and ways of being. If anyone has any more questions they would like us to respond to, do please pop them in the chat. And I think it is really interesting the kind of pathway you've taken in terms of putting this book out there as well. And I love that you've accounted for some of that, the choices to have done the PhD and to have found your own way into writing this project that couldn't be another way and couldn't be put together in another sense. And do you have kind of hopes and aspirations to expand upon this, or to do more kind of creative work developing on your relationship with Iceland in future?
I don't know necessarily with Iceland, although I have to say, you know, Iceland seems, for me, it's sort of this petri dish. I don't want to make it like sound like a laboratory experiment, but it's like anything that happens in Iceland could kind of happen anywhere. It's a really good place to see how cause and effect sort of plays out, because there aren't all the layers of man-made stuff kind of, or palimpsests of man-made stuff to kind of confuse the message. So you can see quite clearly, oh, if you do this, then this happens. So I think it's an incredible muse. And I don't imagine that will ever cease. But I think what I've taken from it is kind of taking my cue from the more than human world, and that's something that I want to do with whatever I do next. I'm just done with you know, only human stories. I just think that's artificial and always has been and always will be. So we need to, yeah. So I have to say, I thought that this book and this trip might be some kind of like closing off period, and that might be my last, and then I go somewhere. But every time I go back, something, it's quite fractal. Something new opens up. It reveals itself in a different way. So yeah, I feel very at home there.
And it's just fascinating to wonder, because obviously your work has been so much about kind of the fortuitous connections you make and the things you can't pre-plan and pre-decide. And yet I think reading the book, we get a real sense of those chance connections, and that's one of the lovely things about it. Those moments which aren't kind of inked in, that nonetheless become hugely significant. And it's probably worth saying that the kind of geographical scope of the book shifts as well, because you have that connection to Kenya as well. And there is that extra geography within this. So this is really a rounded fractal study of self as well. Do you think that you could see yourself appraising sort of more of the landscapes, other landscapes in your life that you've encountered, and returning to those? Would that be something that interested you?
Yeah, definitely. But I think in some ways the sort of the common thread is that, like, through my own experience of it, like, I don't feel like I'm a naturalist or someone who can, I feel like what I can do is synthesize threads of different disciplines and somehow sort of channel it through my own experience to make it like the fathomable and human body size, because sometimes concepts and facts are just too big for us to fathom, especially the kind of facts we're having to deal with now. So if I can bring it down to the scale of the lived human body, then people feel it too, and you're sort of walking along together, experiencing it. That's just my way of doing things. And definitely, I think I see a lot of kind of parallels between the body and the body of the landscape. You know, I see that the way things play out in natural patterning, it's also true, you know, it's also true of us. Like, everything you need to know, you can learn from just sitting down, being quiet and watching, paying attention to nature. You really can. There's really nothing else that we should be doing right now, I think.
That's a wonderful sentiment to linger with, I think. I really like that. And also, as a bookseller, I appreciate that for the quiet days we have that in spades over winter. So I'll definitely adopt that as a more formalized practice to my environmental being. I did want to hold up the book again, but in my excitement at showing, at thinking about the visual, the cover has dropped off, but I do want to show you the wonderful nest end papers that are in here too, because it's such a glorious kind of aspect of the physical object of the book. So I would encourage people, if they haven't already, to go in search of it. And obviously, if they're in Iceland, to maybe just get in touch with Sarah to see if she can give them a steer on where they can acquire the book. But the interior images too are just fantastic. So it's well worth getting to see a copy of the book.
I have a nice little story about the end papers, actually. It illustrates exactly this thing about how chance plays out, and when you try and plan too hard, it doesn't really work. So originally my plan was to have the nest double page spread in the center of the narrative, not exactly in the center of the pages, but the center of the narrative. There's a place that I can identify. It feels like the intimate center. But apparently with bookbinding, like, they're bound in sort of blocks of 16 pages, so you can't choose exactly where an image goes. So it would fall in this really weird place in the middle of a sentence, and I wasn't going to have that, you know. So I was like, I don't want the nest not to be here. And suddenly I thought, well, why couldn't we have end papers? And then it means that we've got end papers in the front and the back, obviously. So then it means that the story is sitting inside the nest instead of the nest being inside the story, which feels a whole lot more appropriate. And luckily my publisher was like, yeah, that makes sense, you know, but that was a chance thing. And also, I just wanted to share my favorite new word, Icelandic word, that I learned on my tour for end papers, which is sörblöð. And sör means like dirt or filth or shit, and blöð means sheet. So it's like a shit sheet. And apparently it's because it was such a keen reading culture there, that farmers and fishermen would come in and in their free time, they just wanted to really dive into a book, and they'd have really grubby hands. And those were the pages they could just sort of wipe their hands off on and not get the inside dirty. And I just that's what I mean about Icelandic directness. It's just, it's a shit sheet. And here we say, end papers.
Linguistically, just straight to the point. I like it.
But it tells the whole story of what it is. Yeah.
And we've had just a couple of other lovely comments, really. Alison Phipps saying that she was minded by your words of those of Mary Oliver in her instructions for living. Pay attention, be astonished, and tell about it. And just general thanks and praise from Sally there. And Ali wondering also whether there might be something Icelandic about running out of toilet roll with that. But I think that's a really harsh comment to make about the end papers there. So we'll not go there. But thank you so much for doing this evening, Sarah. What I will do, I will end the recording and then we can move through so that you get a chance to chat informally to everyone who's been here. But I, on behalf of the bookshop, Sam Reeds and Grassmere, thank you so much for doing this. It's been a real pleasure and privilege to be able to talk to you about this wonderful book. And I hope that everyone gets a chance to read it or even indeed hear the audio book. Yeah.
That's going to be published on the August the 18th, I think it is. And I've narrated it myself because I didn't, well, I think actually I wrote it as something that would sound good read out loud. And I really wanted the Icelandic words to be pronounced as correctly as possible. So I spent 4 days in a studio in Leith and actually I really enjoyed it. So yeah, that will be out in August.
And thank you so much to Will for the most brilliant interview.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Will. I'll just stop.